Welcome to EPG Pakshala, and this is Dr. Shrutaba Sinha, Associate Professor, Department of Islamic History and Culture, University of Kolkata, and I am the coordinator of the module, The Coinage of the Bengal Sultans, 1205 to 1506 AD, which is under the paper Indian Numismatics. Today, we are going to discuss about the coinage of the Bengal Sultans. Before going to the coinage of the Bengal Sultans, we need to know about brief historical information, and the learning objectives of this module are brief historical overview of the pre-Sultanate period, salient features of the currency of the Sultans of Bengal, a brief chronological sequence from 13th century to 16th century, initial coinage of the governors of Bengal in 13th century, coins of the independent sultans of Bengal from 1338 AD, coins of the 15th century under four dynasties of the Bengal sultans, and coinage of the Hussein Shahis, Shuris and the Afghan rulers mainly in the 16th century, which would be followed by a summary. As we have already mentioned that Bengal had a long history of Sultanate rule. It was almost contemporary with Delhi. In 1205 AD, Ikhtiyaruddin Muhammad Bakhtiyar Khilji, he invaded Bengal during the month of May, and a new era started in Bengal. Changes occurred in political and socio-economic scenario as well as in cultural history as well. Before coming to the Islam, before the invasion of this Turkish army in 1205, Bengal had two major imperial power, that is the Palars and the Sainars, who was a ruler in this part of the country, that is the eastern India, for almost three centuries. And in the southeast part of Bengal, there were some small chieftains like the Devas, Khargas, Akaras, Rathas, Chandras and Burmans. Interestingly, the two major ruling power, the Palars and the Sainars, they did not issue any coinage throughout their entire period, at least till date. Apart from a very few dubious coins of the Palar ruler Dharmapal, we did not have any evidence that any coins, either it is in silver or gold or copper, was issued by any of these rulers. In fact, in the inscriptions of the Palars, we find that the mention of the churnis of gold, that is the dust of gold and silver, as well as of cowries, which was actually basically the main medium of exchange. So, when we find that the Islamic or rather we must say that the Turkish army invaded Bengal in 1205, which was almost contemporary when Delhi got their first Sultan, Qutubuddin Aibak, they started to strike coins. As we all know that in Islamic canonical law, there are first two prerogatives when a new sultan or new ruler or a monarch conquest some area or country. They first read their name at the Friday prayer in khutbah, and then they used to strike coin in their own name. Naturally, Bengal was no exception, and Ikhtiyaruddin Bakhtiyar Khilji issued coins immediately after his first invasion, though not in his own name, but in the name of his master, Muhammad bin Sam. And now you can have a look that what is actually where this Bengal kingdom of this Bengal Sultans used to located. It is actually in the easternmost part of India, covering the present day West Bengal, present day Bangladesh, the political division of Bangladesh, and it includes some parts of northern part of Bihar. Now we are coming to the currency system and the coinage of these sultans who ruled in Bengal, ruled over Bengal for more than 350 years. We will have a look at what was the salient features of the currency. The people of Bengal saw a completely alien coinage, the type of coins with which they were not at all accustomed with before. Their language, script, metrology and type were different from the earlier period. The language on the coin is Arabic, script is Nashk and Tughra. The metal used for producing coin or striking coin was grossly silver. Most of the coins were in silver and very few in gold that we find today. Till date, we found very few coins which were struck in gold. And there was no copper coins that has been found so far. So naturally, it raises question that what was the small denomination coins or what was the medium of transaction for the medium of exchange for smaller transaction? And the answer is that it was the cowrie. And apart from that, we are again coming back to the metallic currency, that is the silver currency, which mostly had a very uniform weight standard. Initially it started with 12 gram and then the average weight standard became 10.6 to 10.8 gram. The size of the currency was, the coins was also very uniform. It ranged between 2.6 centimeter to 3.1 centimeter. And throughout the period, we found that there is a very pure silver coinage, unlike Delhi Sultans, where we find, apart from silver, there are many alloy which have been used to produce coin, like Bilon. And other alloys. Copper coins were quite common for Delhi, but we do not see any copper coin or Bilon coins in case of Bengal Sultans. And we should also mention here that after the Suri rule, after Sher Shah Suri came into the power, he revised the weight standard for the coin, as because he introduced the rupee or the rupaiya, which was of 11 grams of weight, it increased a little bit, and he also introduced a new terminology for the copper coin, that is called paisa. Now going to the chronology of the Bengal Sultans, since it was a period of more than three centuries, it started with the governors of Bengal who were deputed by Delhi rulers, Delhi Sultans. And it was from 1205 to 1334, and from 1334 onwards, Bengal became almost independent. During the time of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Bengal was one of the provinces who declared its own independence, and Fakhruddin Mubarak Shah was the first ruler. Then we find the Ilyashahi Sultans, the dynasty of Ilyashahi, who actually became the independent sultan of entire Bengal, both eastern part of Bengal and western part of Bengal. Then we find Ganesh Shahi dynasty, that is a Hindu interregnum that we can say. Later Ilyashahi dynasty or restored Ilyashahi dynasty. Then we find the Habshi interregnum, the Abyssinian people who came to protect the mainly the harems of the Sultan. They ultimately became powerful and came into the power for a brief period of 7 years in 15th century. And then we find the Hussein Shahi dynasty, which was the golden period of the Bengal Sultanate regime. And it was continued for a period of more than 40 years. And then Humayun came and did not stay here for a long time. And Sher Shah ultimately overthrown him, ruled here for Sher Shah and his ancestors ruled here for a period of 15 years or so. And then the Afghan supremacy, a branch of the Suri rulers who came and hold their sway over Bengal for the last, about the remaining 24 years. The salient features of the Bengal Sultanate coinage are essentially, it was monometallic, that is silver, we have already mentioned. Seldom we come across with the gold coins of this period. Coins always having a very prominent and varied enclosure or border design. We will find a number of coins in the following discussion, and you will see that there are a lot of variations in enclosure design and border design. Generally, inscriptions, that is a legend that occupies the both field and margin of the coins, and inscriptions are generally in Arabic. No Persian inscription have ever been used on the any coins of Bengal Sultan. Sometimes we find bilingual coins in the very beginning and in the very at the very end. Leaving motif, though it was forbidden, but in case of Bengal and in case of any the general Islamic coinage of India, we find that at the very beginning there they have used some kind of motif. In case of Bengal, it was a very horseman motif, very powerful and living horseman, and gradually it disappeared within 30 years or so. After 200 years of initial coinage, we find motif of lion motif, which was introduced by another sultan. So far as the typology of the coins are concerned, instead of motif, inscription took its place on both sides, except a few conventional type, as we mentioned. Generally, year of minting coins are always inscribed on the reverse of the coin, and place of minting, name of the mint, are also generally mentioned. Some of the types are there where mint name and dates are absent. Gold coins issued in the name of Muhammad bin Sam by Bakhtiar Khilji, which is the first type that we like to show here or mention here, that is the horseman type, which is completely different from the horseman, the type that we find in case of Delhi issues or Delhi Sultanate issues. And here on this very first coinage, we find, along with Arabic inscription, inscription in local language, that is in Proto-Bengali language, was inscribed, which says a typical phrase, Gauro Vijay, which means on the victory, on the occasion of the victory of Gauro, this coin was being struck. The next governor, as we have mentioned, the first 100 years, more than 100 years, was the period of the Bengal governors. And the next governor, as we find, is Rukunuddin Ali Mardan. He also continued the same horseman type on one side and Arabic inscription on the other side. We can have a look of the on the silver full tanka that is on the top of the slide, and we find a gold quarter tanka of the same ruler. And here also I should elaborate, or I should explain you, what is tanka. Tanka is actually the unit of money which was used by the sultans. It was applicable both for silver as well as for the gold coins, and it was the same word, tanka. Earlier, or in case of Delhi, for gold it was dinar, and for silver it was dirham. But in case of Bengal, it was only tanka, used for both silver and gold. Very soon we will see that the depiction of living motif and indigenous script have disappeared from the coins, because by that time the need of using those motif and the indigenous script was not anymore. By that time, people, the local people, they came to know about the new rulers who came to Bengal and established their new kingdom. The governors of Bengal followed the coin pattern generally of Delhi sultans, so far as their border design and calligraphy are concerned. And as because they were the deputy of the Delhi sultans, so naturally they have followed the type what we have found in case of Delhi. We can have a look at another coins of another governor called Mughizuddin Yusbak. He has got a very beautiful coinage, and if you look at the coin, the calligraphy is beautiful. Calligraphy is a style of writing of inscription that is beautiful, and along with inscription, small flower or scroll designs within the field took place. and these could have a good enclosure style, like double square within a circle, and within that double square the main inscriptions is inscribed, and in the side quadrant, the half circular quadrant on four sides, that is filled up by this creeper or any other scroll design. The coins of the Bengal Sultans actually are not only the medium of exchange, not only used as medium of exchange today for us, it is actually the main source of history from where we came to know about various information in the absence of written document for this period. Like on the coins, we find the phrase which denotes the geographical region from where the land tax have been extracted. We can mention about Mang Kharaze Bang Wa Nadia, which means that land tax, the coin has been struck from the land tax of Bang and Nadia. Bang is one geographical region within this sub-region, within this Bengal, like Mang Kharaze Ral Wa Barind. Ral is Rara region of Bengal, Barind is Barindra region of Bengal, and thereby we could reconstruct that how these people, the Turkish army, penetrated inside the mainland of India, and it took almost 100 years for them to conquer the entire territory of Bengal. And it is absolutely evident from the coins itself that the date on the coins speaks about that when and how they have invaded and penetrated gradually in the inland of Bengal. After 13th century, after this first 100 years, when almost the entire geographical boundary of Bengal came under their control of the governors deputed by Bengal, then we find during the 14th century, from the very beginning of the 14th century, we find that number of production of coin have increased. How it was possible? Because earlier, for the first century, entire first century, 13th century, there was only one mint called Lucknowti, from where almost all the coins have been struck and reported so far. From very beginning of 14th century, Shamsuddin Firoz Shah was the governor at that point of time, and he ruled for almost for 20 years, and number of mints increased from 1 to 3. Two more mints came into operation, and that is how we can say that more coins were also produced. Lucknowti, Bongo and Sunargaon, these are the three mints which we find during this time, with their epithets Hazrat and Khitta. Coins are executed with standard enclosure, as we have found in the earlier centuries, which is very similar to the type of the Delhi Sultan. Coins issued in joint names, not only in one name, but joint names, like the governor along with his son, or it could be the name of the Delhi Sultan along with his appointed deputy or governor in Bengal. These are the typical features of a provincial coinage that generally we find in other parts of India too. During Muhammad bin Tughlaq's reign, calligraphy developed a lot and it became very fine and delicate. Token currency was also issued from Bengal. We know about the token currency of issued by Muhammad bin Tughlaq. He also issued some token currencies from the mint of Bengals also. And under Muhammad bin Tughlaq, there is a very powerful governor, Ghiyasuddin Bahadur Shah. He established his own mint at Khitta Ghiyaspur, which is presently in present Bangladesh. However, this Bahadur Shah was captured by Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and ultimately Bengal became independent after this governor. It was Fakhruddin Mubarak Shah who actually declared himself as the first independent Sultan of Bengal, but not of the entire Bengal, but he declared independence from the eastern part of Bengal and established his own kingdom at Sunargaon, that is in Bangladesh. There was only one mint for his entire period, and he started to use coin in issue coins in prolific number. On every year of his reign, we find coins of Fakhruddin Mubarak Shah. On these coins, you may have noticed that there is a special feature which we did not find in the earlier coins. That's a kind of scoop mark, which we call the Schroff marks, and probably it was taken for to testify the genuinity of the metal, that is the silver. And there are also some mint marks as well. Generally, they do not stamp these kind of marks on the obverse of the coin where the main information was inscribed. These kind of symbols or mint marks and the scoop marks or Schroff marks are seen only on the reverse side. After Fakhruddin Mubarak Shah, in fact, when he was ruling from eastern part of India, we find another sultan in eastern western part of Bengal. He was Alauddin Ali Shah. But after him, Shamsuddin Ilyas Shah came, and he ultimately conquered the entire part of Bengal, and he was the first independent sultan in that particular sense of the term, who ruled absolutely independently from any kind of beyond any control of Delhi from the eastern part of the country. And his coins were rather crude in appearance because the calligraphy was very bold and crude. And coins were produced from the mint of Sonargaon, other than Firozabad, Sonar, and Shahar-e-Nau, which were in the eastern western part of Bengal, and Sonargaon was in the eastern part of Bengal. And here are the coins of Shamsuddin Ilyas Shah. None of the coins are in copper, though the impression is probably of copper, but it is a silver coin with iron incrustation over it. And you can see that the Arabic inscriptions are spreading on both sides. On the reverse side, that is the name of the sultan, where on the upper side, he has proclaimed his allegiance towards the supreme authority of Islam. And he has also declared himself as Sikandar al-Sani, a particular phrase that has been used by him, which means he was the second Alexander. Now we can look at the coins of his son Sikandar Shah, who ruled for a very long period and started with a very crude type of coin from Hazrat Balad Firozabad, the mint. Then he 780 Hijri onwards, he started to struck coins on very fine calligraphy. The monotonous pattern of the circle and square border has been replaced by Sikandar Shah, and it was sometimes hexagon, octagon and multi-scallop circle with very exquisite calligraphy that we may see. We have found one new mint for this sultan also, that is called Chaulistan Urf Arsha Kamru, and the coin on the slide is struck from the same mint. Very few coins are found till date. Sikandar Shah was a very prolific issuer. He constructed several architectural edifices in Bengal, and the famous Adina Masjid was constructed by him. Even during that time, Firoz Shah Tughlaq made two expeditions to Bengal to get control over Bengal once again, but he was not successful. However, after Sikandar Shah, his son Azam Shah came into the power, and he was he also maintained a similar kind of coinage as his father. Azam also issued large number of coins, and single specimen has been reported having Tughra script. Generally, these coins all have the Nash script on their coins, but in case of Azam, we find for the first time a new script came into existence, that is a Tughra script. And during this time, Azam Shah ruled from 1393 to 14 112 or so, and so his reign period continued in the 15th century. And in the beginning of the 15th century, during this period of Azam Shah's successors like Hamza Shah, Bayazid Shah and Firoz bin Bayazid Shah, they were actually not powerful at all. They were the tail-ending rulers of this Iliashahi dynasty. Number of coin production also reduced considerably, and number of variety also reduced. They were actually losing their power and gradually became a puppet ruler at the hand of a Hindu landlord named Raja Ganesh. And after him, we have termed his dynasty as Raja Ganesh Shahi dynasty. Here are the coins of this tail-ender of Iliashahi dynasty, that is Shihabuddin Bayazid Shah and Alauddin Firoz Shah. Calligraphy of the coins is not at all up to the standard. Coming to the coins of coming to the time of Raja Ganesh, we find that this Hindu landlord eventually intervened the Islamic region. He captured the power for a brief period, that is 1416 to 18, in the name of Donuj Mardan Dev, and he and his younger son Mohendra Dev issued coins similar in variety, similar in appearance of the Islamic coins, but in Proto-Bengali script. The enclosure design is very similar to that of Sultanate coins to create ready acceptance in the people's mind. Major three mints were in operation, like Pandunagar, which was Firozabad, Chatigram, that is Chatgaon, and Subarnagram, that is Sonargaon. And date appeared in Shako era instead of Hijri. It was 1339 and 1340 Shakabdo that we do find on the coins of Donuj Mardan Dev and Mohendra Dev. If we can look at the coins, you can find that its appearance is almost similar. It's round, of same weight and same size as of the Islamic Sultanate rulers of Bengal. But the script is no more Arabic. It is a script that is Proto-Bengali, and the language and the script is also Proto-Bengali, where on the obverse side, name of the Sultan is written, and on the reverse, the allegiance or their affiliation towards their religion has been expressed. So is the case for his son Mohendra Deva too. He also struck coins from Chatigram, Pandunagar and Subarnagram, and coins having different kind of enclosure that we have found in on the coins of Sikandar Shah and Azam Shah. One of the son of this Hindu ruler Raja Ganesh converted to Islam, who is known as Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah, and he ruled for a longer period of almost 18 years and issued coins in huge number and of different variety from different mint. Calligraphically, his coin is very significant for introducing Tughra script as a regular feature. Another important feature is introduction of living motif on coins. That is, after a lapse of 202 centuries or 200 years, we find that a kind of lion has been appeared on the coin for the first time on the coins of an Islamic ruler. This is normal type of coin of Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah with inscription on both sides. Next, we will see the coins with the inscription written in Arabic, but the script is Tughra, which is having a very elongated kind of shafts. And this is the lion type coin of Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah, and there are a lot of debate and controversies over this type of coin, what exactly the motif is and how was it used and why it was used by a sultan who is a devout Muslim, etc., etc. There was a brief turmoil phase after Muhammad Shah, and a few rebels issued coins within a span of 1 year. So legend are very crude. Then we find another ruler called Nasiruddin Mahmud Shah, who established a new dynasty and followed the coin pattern introduced by Muhammad Shah. Lion motif continued, parasol motif a new motif called parasol motif that was introduced. He used both Tughra and Nash script on his coin, and Mahmud Shah started to issue coins from two other mint, which is called Khazana and Darul Zarb. Khazana means the treasury and Darul Zarb means the mint. So it could be, it could not be another mint, but the royal treasury and the royal mint has been termed as a mint name. And these are the coins of Nasiruddin Mahmud Shah, and as we can find, inscriptions, rather calligraphy is very crude. The upper one with the Nash script and the lower one with Tughra script on obverse and Nash script on reverse. He started to use Kalma. That is one significant aspect and feature of the Bengal Sultanate coinage, that using Kalma on one side of their coins. So Mahmud Shah started that, and along with that he continued with the tradition of lion type of his earlier, of the earlier sultan. He introduced a new type that is called parasol. It's the inscriptions is within a kind of umbrella that is called parasol type. He was succeeded by his son Rukunuddin Barbak Shah, and Barbak Shah was succeeded by Shamsuddin Yusuf Shah. These sultans, they Barbak Shah ruled for a long time, though Yusuf Shah has a very short period, but they all issued quite a good number of coins of different variety. Barbak's coinage is well known for his crude calligraphy. He introduced a three chambers type of coin, which was new to the existing variety and type. There are the coins of Barbak Shah, all these having very crude calligraphy on the first coin, but at the same time we can find that beautiful calligraphy were also there, which means that in the Royal Mint there were different kind of or different standard of calligrapher. Some were very efficient and some were not that efficient. Shamsuddin Yusuf's coinage was not of varied type. He ruled for a period of 7 years only, and he was succeeded by Jalaluddin Fath Shah, who can claim to have a fascinating coinage. Apart from lion, he introduces solar symbol and some other new variety with religious legend. This feature is absolutely unique, and we never find such legend in the entire period. The Hafshis overthrown the last sultan of Mahmud Shahi dynasty and held their sway over Bengal for a brief period of 6 years. We can have a look of the coin of Jalaluddin Fath Shah, which was bit unique in character. The calligraphy is quite different. We find here a new mint name, that is Mandaran, and on the margin, on the outside of the field, we find several different type of marginal designs, floral designs, along with the date on the coin. These Hafshis followed the pattern of the Mahmud Shahi coins, so far as the legend formula and the enclosure is concerned. A good number of gold coins have also been found, along with silver coins with neat calligraphy. The last sultan of the Hafshi, that is Muzaffar Shah, he declared himself as Kamta Mardan after he plundered Kamta in the present Assam area. These are the gold coins of Hafshi Sultans Saifuddin Firoz Shah, which are extremely rare, and we generally do not find these coins very often. He has also used Kalma on his coins, on the obverse of the coin. Along with that, he has used other inscriptions also in Arabic. The most powerful Hafshi ruler was Shamsuddin Sultan Muzaffar Shah, and he was dethroned by his chief minister Hussein Shah in 1493 AD, and who eventually established the most important ruling period, that is generally called the golden period of Bengal, that is the Hussein Shahi period. And these all Hussein Shahi period was ruled by four successive rulers: Hussein Shah, Nusrat Shah, Alauddin Firoz Shah and Ghiyasuddin Mahmud Shah. They issued for more than 40 years, and they were all very prolific issuer of coins. There are coins which are very informative in that way. giving lot of information regarding the kingdom expansion. Like Hussein Shah has conquered or he had a victory over Kamta, Kamrup, Orissa and Jajnagar. Everything is written on his coins. So as a historical document, they have served immensely to the historian on to reconstruct the history of Bengal. So in the during the 16th century, the Hussein Shah dynasty, who were ruled over Bengal, they witnessed a very stable political situation, and it was almost for a period of next almost for 50 years. The last sultan of the dynasty, Mahmud Shah, lost his power at the hand of Humayun in 1538. The coin which has been later used as pendant, you can see, have a loop attached to it. It is a gold coin of Sultan Hussein Shah, having a very detailed inscription with neat calligraphy on the reverse, and on the obverse we find the kalma within a very multi-scallops. And there is another gold half tanka of Hussein Shah, which is extremely rare. Here I must mention that apart from the general tanka of one unit, all these rulers of Bengal, they also issued fractional coins too. That is a very small denominational coin, half coin, 1/4 coin, 1/8 coin, 1/16 of a unit was also there. But they are extremely rare. We generally do not find those. The next ruler of the Hussein Shah period is Nasiruddin Nusrat Shah, who was issued coins with two new mint names on either side. And sometimes he also used two dates, which is very confusing, and there are a lot of debates about the usage of two dates and two mints. He introduced various new designs, and his concurrent issues are pretty common. Concurrent issues means he issued coins along with his son or with his brother. Important issue is Tirhut Mardan. Like Muzaffar Shah of Habshi dynasty, after plundering Tirhut in North Bihar, Nusrat Shah issued coins with a phrase called Tirhut Mardan. This is general type of coin of Nusrat Shah with a very nice border design. He was succeeded by Alauddin Firoz Shah, who ruled for a very short period and ultimately dethroned by Ghiyasuddin Mahmud Shah, his uncle. Firoz Shah followed his father's coin type, including his Tirhut Mardan, and Mahmud Shah's coin are mostly of Badarshahi type. That is completely a new type, which was very interesting. It's a kind of type which followed from the Delhi Sultan. Some of the dates on his coins indicate concurrent issue also, which was quite common. Here we end the mainstream of the Bengal Sultanate coinage. These are the coins of the last two rulers of Hussein Shahi dynasty, Alauddin Firoz Shah and Ghiyasuddin Mahmud Shah. This is the Badarshahi type, that the term Badarshahi is written in a small circle within the field, and the rest of the area is filled up with the standard legend of Mahmud Shah. After short occupation of the Mughals and the Suris, Afghans took hold of the power of Bengal, and they have issued coins which were different in appearance, pattern of legend, weight standard and enclosure pattern. As we have mentioned, that Sher Shah Suri introduced a weight standard which is slightly higher of 11 grams in weight. And that became the standard for the Suri period and the following Afghan period too. And at the same time, Sher Shah also introduced the bilingual system, that is writing the name of the Sultan in Devanagari script along with the Arabic script. And mint marks are also very prominent for this period. So we can have a look of the coins of the tail enders of the Bengal, who are known as the Afghans. The coin of Muhammad Ghazi Shah, the first Afghan ruler of Bengal, which is absolutely following the type of Sher Shah Suri legend, that is kalma on obverse within a square, and the other legend on the reverse, which is containing the name of the Sultan on the reverse. Along with that, mint name and date are inscribed on the four side quadrants of the coin. Same is the type for the other sultans of this period, namely Ghiyasuddin Bahadur Shah and Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah Ghazi, and the last ruler Daud Shah Kararani, the last Afghan ruler of Bengal. So all their coins are absolutely stereotyped. There is no variation, quite common type, and issued from one or two mints. The new mint Tanda came into existence because the capital was shifted to Tanda, which is in present day Jharkhand area. Just to sum up the entire discussion, we can say that the coinage of Bengal Sultan is one of the most important coinage among the other provincial coinage of medieval Indian numismatics. It was a stable coinage, continued for a period of more than 350 years. It was a monometallic coinage, that is mostly of silver. Coins are mostly of silver with occasional and rare gold coins. The monetary system was dual, because there is not only the silver currency, not only the metal currency, Kauri was also equally popular and was in circulation for smaller transaction. Uniform weight standard, size and shape throughout the period have been maintained. Inscriptions based on typology, though exceptions of horseman type and lion type, where motifs of living men have been used. And starting with one mint, it's very important to mention that starting with one mint, a large number of mint came into operation during the entire period, and as well as the peak period of the Sultanate. And for any further information, you can consult and go to the e-page or the web page of this EPG Pathshala. There you find the references of books, the very useful books on Bengal Sultanate coinage, and the latest one that we can say, it's by Stan Gurun and J.P. Goenka, The Coins of Indian Sultanates. But there are several other reference books that we may mention. The first one is by Abdul Karim, A Corpus of Muslim Coins of Bengal down to 1538 AD. There is a very good reference of Dilip Rajgur, where not only the coins of Bengal but also coins of other sultanates are there. And finally, there are several websites that you may consult. Thank you very much.